Hello and welcome to another edition of Our Faith, Our Diocese. I'm Dan Gallagher. Earlier this month, a missionary image of Our Lady of Guadalupe visited several churches in the diocese, including Gate of Heaven here in Dallas. This image is an exact replica of the one that the Blessed Mother left on the cloak of St. Juan Diego in Mexico back on December 12, 1531. As you're about to see in our opening segment, the mission of this image is to promote the sanctity of the family, a culture of life, and a civilization of love. Father, first of all, why are you and the rest of this parish community so excited about hosting the missionary image here at Gate of Heaven?
Well, I just think it gives us an opportunity to share with the entire community the opportunity of a most beautiful image of our Blessed Mother, Our Lady of Guadalupe, and that all the graces that can be received through her and the blessings that come not only to this parish community, but to the broader community at large. And so we're very excited to have this opportunity to have her with us this afternoon.
When you gaze on this image, why do you consider this such a powerful image of our Blessed Mother?
I just think that what strikes me is the abundance of color that is in Our Lady's cloak. And also when you look into her face, she's a very compassionate, kind, welcoming, sympathetic kind of image that comes forward. And this way then it invites you to come forward to her with all of your difficulties, your challenges, and that she's there to strengthen you, to calm you down, and to bless you.
Why were you so excited about bringing this image to Gate of Heaven?
I didn't know a real lot about Our Lady of Guadalupe and her purpose to bring the Americas to a continent of life. And personally, it made an opportunity to consecrate myself to the Lady of Guadalupe. Now, I've consecrated myself to the Blessed Mother forever, every day, almost every day. Jesus and Mary, I consecrate my life to you. But this made an opportunity, a new window of faith, a new birth, really. It was a new birth from the Blessed Mother. And she shared that kind of a new opportunity, new life, new purpose for the future. And that's why I want to share this with the parish, with the world, really. And our prayer group, the Divine Will, Living in the Divine Will prayer group, wanted to do that. Our women wanted to bring Our Lady of Guadalupe.
For those that come this afternoon for both adoration and also to venerate this beautiful image behind you, what are you hoping they will take away from this prayerful experience this afternoon?
Oh, healing, deep spiritual healing, growth, love, joy, peace, the things that everybody wants, that they would receive it.
Last question. When you look at this image behind you, what do you think of this incredible image?
Well, she's an icon. That's the words of God in that picture. It's not a painting. It's the words of God in that image that she left.
On Sunday, May 12th, the Diocese of Scranton held its annual Mother's Day Adoption Mass. Bishop Bambara served as the principal celebrant and homilist for the liturgy, which recognizes all mothers, including foster and adoptive mothers.
I love this Mass. I get very emotional every year I attend. I get to see the babies that were placed for adoption through St. Joe's. They're growing up. And we have a strong following of adoptive families that bring their babies to this Mass every year, and I have the privilege of seeing them grow up. It's such a blessing because I have the honor and privilege to work with women who have challenges in their lives where they believe they can't raise a baby, and they trust St. Joe's to work with us and place their baby for adoption. And it's an honor to work with them. And it's a very selfless, brave, beautiful decision that they make. I just think that it's a beautiful day to honor all mothers, and I love that every mother is being honored. It's the foster mothers, it's adoptive mothers, it's the birth mothers who place their babies for adoption. It's honoring women who work so hard every day to pour everything that they have into caring for babies and children.
No, in the process of sharing with us the call to holiness, Pope Francis reminded us to keep our eyes opened to what he called the saints who live next door. I love that image, the saints who live next door. They're not just up in the heavens. They're not just locked away in a monastery or convent or church. They are all around us.
We decided to adopt a child because we have so much love to give, and our ability to have a child, unfortunately, was not in God's plan. We were able to find within our prayer life and ourselves the strength to move to the next best step, which was to look at adoption. We are internally blessed for the adoption of our beautiful daughter, Penelope. Well, it's a vocation. Parenthood is a vocation. And my wife and I knew that we had this this gift of love, and we wanted to share our love and have a family, and it's an extension of our faith, adoption, an extension of who we are as Catholics. And to adopt is to truly fulfill our marital vocation and our love for each other. It's a special, certainly a special celebration, not just because of Mass at the cathedral, but it's a special Mass in that we are, you know, recognizing all the adopted parents there, not just within the Diocese of Scranton, but universally. And when you can come together as a Catholic community, as a Catholic family, to share in that gift, to share in the gift of the Mass, to express our love as a Catholic family, and our children are the future. So to bring him here at Mass, here at the cathedral, to bring our daughter here for the first time is truly just a special moment in our lives.
Coming up on Saturday, May 25th, Bishop Bambara will be ordaining two of our seminarians to the diaconate at the Cathedral of St. Peter. As you're about to see, Thomas Dwancic from St. John Vianney Parish in Scott Township and Andrew McCarroll from St. Robert Bellarmine Parish in Wilkes-Barre will be one step closer to attaining their dream of becoming priest when they're ordained as transitional deacons. Joining me now, it's a pleasure to welcome both Tom and Andrew as they prepare for this milestone on their journey to the priesthood. Tom, Andrew, thanks so much for being here today. Tom, I'd like to start off by asking you a question about your own personal vocation. How and when did the call to the priesthood come about?
You know, I was always attracted to the priesthood. I was always attracted to the Mass. I was always asking questions about it. But like most people, I sort of put it to the side. I sort of ran away from it. And it wasn't really until high school when I started to take it seriously. I was a participant in a program called by Name, where the teachers recommended young men who might potentially have a vocation. And for the remainder of my high school time, I met with, at the time it was Father Don Williams, the vocation director. And through conversations with him and other young men who were considering the call, I was able to discern that this is where God was leading me. And I was through high school and ultimately college that I discerned that I was being called to enter, to take the step into seminary.
And Andrew, in your case, how did your call to the priesthood?
Well, it's really funny how Tom and I's vocation journey is kind of similar in that way. Growing up, I thought about the priesthood. It was an option. We were involved in my home parish as an altar server, and I got to know a lot of the priests. So it was in the back of my mind that priesthood was a potential, and there was something very attractive about priestly ministry. But when I was in high school, we also, at Holy Redeemer, we had a similar program, the Called by Name program. So my name was recommended. And I began that conversation with, at that time, the vocation director, Father Don Williams. And we just began to talk slowly about what that would look like or how I felt called and really taking advantage of some discernment opportunities. But eventually that led to him inviting me to visit the college seminary at that time, which was in Douglaston, New York. And going there, I really found a place where there were guys like me who were asking the same questions, who were taking prayer very seriously and discerning a call to the priesthood. And I thought, you know, that was my next step forward. So out of high school, I entered into the college program. And since then, year after year, being in a discernment program, and here I am today.
Tom, both you and Andrew studied at St. Mary's Seminary in Baltimore. What was that experience like?
Yeah, it's been great. I'm just so fortunate to be able to dive into the deeper, you know, aspects of theology, of scripture, of the history of the church. You know, I shared with my parents. I wish everyone in the pews could study this stuff. I wish everyone could learn about it. And then not only that, but to be able to be in a community designed for men who are making this decision, who are discerning this call, to be able to study with them, but to pray with them, to hang out with them, to go to an Orioles game with them. It's incredibly formative, and it's been a wonderful experience.
And Andrew, do you feel blessed with the experience you had at St. Mary's?
I do. Of course, the academic aspect is great at St. Mary's Seminary and University in Baltimore. But also being with guys who are asking the same questions that I am, to be able to be with them and to minister with them. I think we have a very strong pastoral program, so to be able to go into hospitals and parishes and other pastoral ministries and to serve and to live out that vocation we feel called to.
Looking at your family and friends, how supportive have they been over the last few years as you've followed your vocation?
It's been tremendous, particularly in these past few weeks as I'm leading up to the actual day of ordination. The number of people who have reached out to me either by phone or even just sending a text saying, you know, they've been praying for me has been incredible. Ultimately, my parents have been the bedrock of support for this vocation. I remember still when I first told them over the phone, actually, that I wanted to enter seminary, and it was about a two-hour conversation with them. But since then, they've been my biggest supporters, and honestly, without them and honestly all my friends and family praying for me, I wouldn't have been able to make it to where I am today.
Andrew, over the last few summers, you and Tom have had the opportunity to work at some of our parishes, working the front lines with our pastors. How has that experience really enriched your own vocation?
Actually, I think it's very essential to our formation program that we're in parishes, that we're doing the work and the life of a priest, that we're able to minister to other people. So currently I'm at St. Boniface and St. Lawrence parishes in Williamsport, which has been a great year for me to be able to get to know people and to minister them in not just a summer program, but a whole year program to be able to know people and to serve them.
And in your case, Tom, you'll be going to St. Jude Parish in Mountaintop?
Yes, I did like Andrew, I did a pastoral year last year at St. Jude's in Mountaintop, as well as St. Mary's in Dorrance. And to be able to be at those two churches with Father Joe Ivanko and Father Filbert, as well as the school, St. Jude's School, it's been tremendous. You really see God's work in the people right there. It's incredible.
Andrew, as we move ever closer to that moment where you'll be ordained as a transitional deacon, how excited are you feeling right now?
I'm pretty excited. It's a moment that affirms a lot of what I've been preparing for this entire time, to be able to lay down that floor and to submit to God and the church to say that I'm willing to serve with my life to the church. But to be honest, there's a part of me, I'm nervous, not necessarily afraid or scared, but nervous that it's the next step in my journey that has a certain seriousness to it, but also is something that I think is very joy-filled. And I'm looking forward to taking that next step and ministering in this particular way as a deacon.
Tom, how grateful are you for both the prayerful and financial support you've received from faithful over the last few years? And are you looking forward to the opportunity to give something back to those people who have been there for you?
Yes, honestly, words can't express how grateful I am for how generous God's people are. I mean, from supporting the diocesan financial appeal to our annual vocations golf tournament in the summer, to how many people, again, just say, I'm praying for you, or they tell my parents, I'm praying for your son. It's truly humbling. It makes me realize that I'm completely unworthy of this call, and yet through the ministry of service, which the deacons are called to, I will be able to, in some small fraction, give back to them as a token of my gratitude for everything they've done for me.
We come to you now from Good Shepherd Academy School in Kingston, where members of the school's junior high choir are getting ready for a big concert at St. Ignatius Parish. As it celebrates its 75th anniversary, the Catholic Choral Society is once again trying to showcase the talents of local youth from northeastern Pennsylvania.
I truly am very proud, privileged, and actually honored to be the director of the Catholic Choral Society. Imagine being in a chorus that has been around for 75 years, probably one of the longest running choruses in northeastern Pennsylvania, maybe in Pennsylvania. And it's just a testament to our members, past and the present, to be a part of this organization. They come so faithfully every week to rehearse from September until May, rehearsing for our upcoming concerts and performances. And it's a very cohesive group. It's a family at this point. It really is. And as our actual originator of the Choral Society, Norbert Betty, way back in 1949, he set standards for us where we are to do the traditional sacred literature and popular Broadway, and especially opera. That was a mainstay of the Choral Society for all these years.
Another part of this group that I find fascinating is the fact that this Sunday, as an example, at St. Ignatius, you'll be featuring the youth choir from here at Good Shepherd Academy. And this is something you've done before in the past, where you're showcasing not only the talents of the Catholic Choral Society, but the young and upcoming singers and musicians from this area. Why is that an important part of what we do as the Catholic Choral Society? Why do we enjoy inviting young talent to join us for these concerts?
That is part of our mission of the Catholic Choral Society, to invite young students to perform. And we do so every year for the spring concert. We have different schools performing at each concert. When they see these different levels of students performing, they see everybody enjoying the music. They hear the difference as we go from elementary, those delicate young voices. It's just so beautiful. And then going all the way up through the adult. And it's something for them to aspire to, for something for their future. It's not something that after they finish high school, they don't do anymore. It's a gift that they will have the rest of their lives and hopefully join us. And their other choirs, maybe their church choirs. There's always music that can be sung.
Since I was a child, I just always loved singing, and sometimes I get afraid during crowds when, like, I'm singing alone or something, but choir, there are so many people in choir who love singing, and that makes it a million times better. It is phenomenal. Everyone sings so beautifully, and I love the different parts, like alto, sopranos and all that. I just love music. When I grow up, I would even like to be a music teacher or something. I just am inspired by music.
It's the 75th anniversary, so we're excited because it's a milestone for the Catholic Choral Society, and I love to perform in front of people, and it's fun for me, and I enjoy it. I'm very pleased with how we're singing, doing our parts that we have for separate parts in the song. It makes me happy, and I can do it with my friends also, so that's something that I like to do. It's fun. It makes me happy to see all the audience clapping and being like hyped up from the music that we've been performing.
My God, I am yours for time and eternity. Lord, I am yours forever. It's you that must teach us to trust in your providence. Loving Lord, my God, I am yours forever.
I've always loved music throughout my life, but last year when I did my school play, I gained a love for singing music and performing in front of crowds. So when Mr. Hanlon provided the opportunity to join the choir, I was ecstatic, and of course I joined. And I've been doing it ever since. It's awesome. We've been practicing for quite a while, every week, twice a week, actually. I believe we're very ready. I love being a tenor, hearing us sing our parts and everyone else around me singing a different part, but all coming together. It's beautiful. It sounds great. I mean, like 75 years, that's a very long time in being able to perform with the Catholic Choral Society during this milestone. That's incredible and such an honor, and I'm beyond grateful for that. I mean, these people, they're incredible. It makes me less nervous on stage, performing anywhere really, knowing that everyone around me loves music just as much as I do. So that helps.
On Saturday, June 8th, hundreds of women from around the diocese will be gathering at Marywood University to take part in the annual Catholic Women's Conference. As you'll see in our closing segment, the conference committee is hoping that those in attendance will leave this gathering with a new excitement about their Catholic faith and a desire to share that faith with others. Joining me now to discuss the conference in greater detail, it's a pleasure to welcome Jackie Lewandowski, who is a member of the planning committee for the Women's Conference. Jackie, welcome. Jackie, for the benefit of someone watching this interview today and who has never been to one of these conferences, how would you describe it? What transpires during the course of a typical conference?
You know, it's like something that you'll never experience. It's so exciting, and you know, we call it Refresh Your Faith, a Catholic Women's Conference. It truly does refresh your faith. We say it's like a spa day for your soul. So, you know, you start off and there's breakfast and all these women are coming, all your sisters in Christ are coming together, and we start off with Mass. How exciting that Bishop Bambara is celebrating Mass to kick off the day with Mass and the Holy Eucharist. And we also have, you know, some great speakers the people that speak are just so motivating, so filled with the Holy Spirit. You know, it's so beautiful. We have lunch and there's a marketplace, and we also have the opportunity for reconciliation, you know, which is always, to me, it's always like, oh, like I feel so good after, you know, you go to reconciliation. And, you know, you just go through this day and, you know, the speakers are so motivating, so filled with the Holy Spirit. You become so close to God. It's just, sometimes you just feel like you're a million miles away, and, you know, it's just you and your sisters in Christ and God, and, you know, nothing else matters at that moment. For me, that's how it was for me when I first went.
One of the things I've noticed, because we've been covering it for the last several years, when I talk to women who have been to this conference, they talk about the power that's in moments like that where you look around and you realize you're not alone in your Catholic faith, and you see hundreds of other women who share common values, who share a common love for their Catholic faith. Why is there such power in moments like that?
Well, it's true. So you're sitting there and you're in this room with 400 women, 400 of your sisters in Christ, and you know, you feel like you're not alone, and everybody, you know, we share the same values, and you know, it's just a beautiful moment. It's a beautiful moment with your sisters, with the Lord, and you know, I just think it's so much fun to share these moments with your sister. Like, we're sisters, we're all you know, we're all on different walks of life. Everyone has a story. But at that moment, we're one body. We're one body in Christ. And, you know, it's just indescribable, you know. But it's just a really good feeling in the heart and being there with your sisters in Christ and the Holy Spirit and, you know, women of all ages. It's just something that, you know, you can't even express it in words, but it's just such a great, refreshing feeling.
As an observer watching this conference over the last few years, I think one of the moments that is a highlight from my point of view is the time to break bread and just sit down at a table and share a meal with other women, because you see the fellowship that develops. Why do you think those new friendships are such a key part of what this conference is all about?
I feel that you're always, you know, looking for people that, you know, are like you, that you can just be yourself. And I mean, you could go with a bunch of friends or you could go alone. I went alone. And I mean, I just walked up to a table and I'm like, hey, can I sit here? And they're like, of course. And here, you know, you're talking about your family, your children, you know, the Lord, the conference, how you feel their energy because they're excited about it too and refreshed and invigorated. So I think those moments are so important. And that conference truly provides that.
That's all the time we have for now. On behalf of the staff here at Catholic Television, I'd like to thank you for joining us today and invite you to tune us in again for our next edition of Our Faith, Our Diocese.